Good afternoon. Welcome to Queens Public Library's Ecology and Birding in Long Island City Waterfront Parks. I'm Lynn from the Children's Library Discovery Center. And during, well, a little bit about the library before we got started with our program. This month, we're celebrating Women's History Month. Queens Public Library honors the leadership, strength, and power of all individuals who identify as women. We salute our local trailblazers who, thanks to their determination and hard work, have made significant contributions to Queens and opened a world of opportunities for generations to come. Learn more about our celebrations at queenslib.org/WHM2022. And tax season is here. Queens Public Library has compiled a resource list of partner organizations who can provide you with virtual tax help. Visit our blog on queenslibrary.org for more information. Try BrainFuse Help Now, which offers live online tutoring and homework help every day from 2 to 11 p.m. An adult learning center, also, and a 24-hour writing lab and more. Visit queenslib.org/brainfuse to access this online service. Today's program is one of many for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. We hope to see you next week on April 2nd at 2 p.m. here on YouTube Live with What Happens When We Flush? New York City's Wastewater Story. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by the City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Protection. Check the comments. Please add to the comments and type in your questions in the chat. We'd love to hear from our viewers out there. We'll have a question and answer session at the end of the program. And to introduce our guests today, we're so happy to have with us three wonderful folks. First of all, Mark Christie, a longtime Hunters Point resident who has helped guide the transformation of the neighborhood into a more sustainable, natural, and inviting place to live. He was on the task force for the design and development of both Gantry Plaza State Park and Hunters Point South Park. He's a founding member of the Friends of Gantry State Park, Gantry Plaza State Park, and vice president of the Hunters Point Parks Conservancy. He's also founder of the president of the Friends of Queens Library at Hunters Point and president of the Hunters Point Community Development Corporation. Jessica Sechrist is the manager of programming and development at Hunters Point Parks Conservancy. She's been working in urban parks for more than a decade. Jessica's work in urban parks focuses on keeping parks accessible and engaging for all users through creative programming and maintaining high levels of cleanliness and horticulture. She also works to bring space-specific environmental education programs appropriate for diverse audiences to the Long Island City waterfront. And last, and of course not least, Gabriel Willow is a naturalist with a particular passion for birds and urban spaces. He's an environmental educator and ecological tour guide here in New York City, where he leads tours and teaches classes for New York City Audubon and Wave Hill. His tours focus on seeking out the overlooked and ignored elements of wildness hiding all around us, ranging from boat tours on the East River to kayaking on Newtown Creek, to seeking the elusive peregrine falcons nesting on skyscrapers near Wall Street. He has created programs for Lincoln Center, the Morgan Library and Museum, the New York Botanical Garden, and more. He's also an artist, illustrator, and DJ, and vice president of the Linnaean Society of New York. And it's all yours, folks. Take it over.
Thank you, Lynn, for that beautiful introduction. As Lynn said, I'm Mark Christie. Today, I'm very proud to say that I was involved in these task forces. It started in 2001 when I became involved in a task force for Gantry Plaza State Park. And then in 2006 for Hunters Point South Park. I've been in many meetings discussing resiliency and sustainability on the waterfront, and it's been a pleasure to contribute to what we have here on the waterfront. Today, Hunters Point South Park has been one of the, I call it the biggest classrooms that we have. It's one, the best in wedge, waterfront, edge, resiliency. And you could see from here, the first slide depicts the bioswales with native plantings, grasses that absorb the runoff from our streets, street side. The heavy metals are filtered out by the grasses, the roots of these grasses. The excess flow overflow goes into the gabion, that metal structure there with stones. It's filtered out, and some of it is stored to irrigate and water the entire park. I think it's one of the nicest features of the park that people don't really know that it's there, but I'm proud of it. Underneath here, on this great oval, is stored 600,000 gallons of water from either from excess runoff, or if there's a surge, it can absorb all that amount of water, 600,000 gallons of water. And it helps in the protection of the entire waterfront in the event of a flooding, a major flooding event. Here we have the riprap that protects the entire coast on the waterfront, with native grasses planted on the edge there that sustain the berms. The roots grow very deep into the soil and protects the entire waterfront, protects it from erosion. And here we're noticing that there's some grasses that are protecting the berm. On that berm, we had an invasive species of weeds that actually killed off the grasses that were planted. And it's being amended by removing all the weeds that were there and corrected by replanting the good stuff. So at this point, we have to, it's essential to have volunteers in our park to help to control the weeds. I think that without these berms, the upland would not be as protected as from floods and storm surges. It's very essential to have these protective berms along the waterfront. It's resilient. It's one of the features in the park that protects the park and the upland for the 100-year flood event, if we do have such. Here, again, another feature of the park is the salt marsh. It protects the waterfront in the event of a storm, but this also pays homage to what Queens, the waterfront of Queens, was from here to almost 2 miles inland to Queens Plaza. This is the salt marshes that fill in twice a day with brackish water from the East River, which is actually an estuary, but it floods twice a day. And it's one of a very beautiful feature in the park that I hope that more people could come and enjoy. And Jessica, I think you could take over from here with this, please.
So this just sort of gives an overview of why the resilient features are so important to the waterfront and why this particular stretch of the waterfront is doing so much in really leading the development of sustainable and resilient architecture features in parks in New York City. Because you can see the areas in green on the first map show the extent, the historic extent of wetlands in the city before the areas were developed. And then if you look in the middle map, that shows the extent of flooding from Sandy, and you can see how closely it follows a lot of that. This is a very common theme in resiliency and in responding to older development, where if you have wetlands that have been filled in, you then see a really serious increased flood risk. In 1852, actually, as part of the development of Long Island City, as it was being heavily industrialized, they leveled one of the hills in the neighborhood and managed to fill in all of the wetlands. So they used to stretch all the way over to Fifth Avenue and even sometimes over to Vernon before they were infilled and just led up to a bulkhead at the current extent of the waterfront. You can also see a little bit, they added the very southern point where the current phase two of Hunters Point South is as part of that infill. But for a long time, rather than it being a wetland that was able to respond to the tides, it was just standard dirt infill concrete bulkheads, which means that during Sandy and during any other major flood events, there was no place for any of the water to go. There was no place for a lot of the native species that had been living in those wetlands to nest, to live. And so by designing the parks, both Gantry Plaza and Hunters Point South, to be much more mindful of the way in which the water and the land meet, and by putting in these resilient features that Mark was talking about, a lot of the flood risks have been slightly mitigated, both through just building capacity to absorb a huge amount of flood water and by setting up berms that can stop some storm surges and by allowing the water to flow in and out without losing all of that soil because of the types of grasses that are being used and because of the choice to include the tidal marshlands, which should help protect the neighborhood as a whole in the event of the next major flood, which unfortunately are coming a little bit more often than 100 years these days, it seems. Yeah. So. And then maybe Gabriel can start giving us sort of an overview of the ways in which these features not just help resiliency, but also are really essential for improving the overall health of the ecology and of the species that live in the area.
Absolutely, sure. So as Mark mentioned, this park and a number of others on the New York City waterfront are located on what's called an estuary. So even though the East River has river in its name, it's not actually a river. The Hudson River is a river and also an estuary. So I just want to define our terms a little bit. I guess I won't make you go all the way back to that first slide, Jessica, but if folks could remember that first slide where there was the multicolored map of a section of New York City and you had Manhattan, the Bronx. Oh, boom, look at that.
You can jump.
Magic. there we go. Thanks. So we've got, of course, New Jersey over there on the left, that tan area. Staten Island is a little bit off the map, is the purple. The Bronx up there is the red. Manhattan, Queens, and Brooklyn. And the airports get their own label and color. So New York City is a little unusual in that it's an archipelago. It's a collection of islands. Brooklyn and Queens are both located on Long Island. Manhattan is an island, of course. Staten Island has it in the name. The Bronx is the only borough that is attached to the mainland. Actually, a number of large cities through human history have been built on estuaries or large rivers. That's a pretty common thing because there's such rich ecosystems. So where you have the biggest cities, some are landlocked, like Mexico City, one of the biggest cities in the world, but it's built on a former marsh, a freshwater marsh, but a marsh nonetheless. So we're talking about tidal marshes here. So an estuary is where you have saltwater and freshwater mixing and meeting the land. And they're typically tidal because so the tides will push up more salt water on a rising tide. And so the Hudson River has some detectable salt all the way up to about Poughkeepsie. And it's tidal all the way to Troy. and then there's a dam and that stops the tides. But on a falling tide, it would be fresh water coming out into New York Harbor. And on a rising tide, it would push the salt water up. Now, the East River is a little different. It goes on out off the map here, but it's attached to Long Island Sound. So the East River is connected to the ocean on both ends, Long Island Sound, out past Connecticut, and then New York Harbor. So it's not actually a river, but we call it the river. And you can see along Manhattan, right where Hunters Point South is and Gantry Plaza State Park, it's one of the narrower sections. Well, it's one of the wider sections of the parts that are called the East River. But just the area of the East River running along Manhattan is sort of one of the narrowest parts. So you have really fast tidal speeds. And it would have been encircled by marshes. Manhattan, Queens, that part of Brooklyn would have historically had tidal marshes. The Gowanus Canal would have had them as well. And unfortunately, as Jessica mentioned, a lot of those have been replaced with hard edges. That's what a bulkhead is. It's just like a seawall of concrete and stone. Okay, so now we can skip on back to our Spartina. So here we go. Wow, boom. This is the restored marsh within the park, Hunters Point Park South. And there's a few iconic species that are typical of tidal marshes in estuaries. And one of the most important is a genus of grass called Spartina. Now it's actually, I don't remember, they did some genetic studies and they renamed the genus. It turns out it's related to some other plant, but everybody still calls it Spartina. But there might be some botanist who's like, so yeah, the name is no longer Spartina. It's some other word with an S, I think. But anyway, I still call it Spartina. It's catchy. So the taller one in the foreground here is Spartina patens or patens. And that's usually on higher ground. And it's also known as salt hay. And farmers used to, like the Dutch, when they first arrived in the area, they had farms in tidal zones. And they would actually cut that hay at low tide. And cows really liked it, and sheep. They often like salty things. So probably a little bit of salt flavor. It was like, extra tasty hay. So that was very important. And in the background is a lower salt marsh cordgrass, or Spartina alterniflora, which is the really salt tolerant and water fluttering tolerant Spartina. And so that'll often get completely submerged at high tide, whereas the Spartina patens likes to keep its feet dry and it's higher up. And there's some other plants around the edges that we're gonna talk about. Here we go. So on slightly higher ground.
Sorry.
That's all right, there we go. So this has a name you may have heard of before. This plant is called, it's a mallow flower, related to hibiscus, that beautiful sort of large flower with a little fancy thing in the middle. But this one grows in marshes, right? Salt marshes in this case. So its name is marshmallow. Does that ring a bell? Marshmallow. Say it fast. Marshmallow.
Marshmallow.
Yeah, like what you put on a s'more. So originally, a marshmallow was the name of this type of mallow flower, but it has a starchy root that I believe is also medicinal. I don't know what, I think it's good for a cough. And so when kids would get sick, their parents would grind up this root and make a confection out of it, but to make it more palatable, tastier, they'd mix it with sugar. So you got this starch and a sugar, and the marshmallow originally was actually kind of like medicine. Now, I don't think marshmallows today, before all the kids, if there's any kids watching, you go say, hey, can I have a s'more next time I have a sore throat? They don't have any of this flower or this root in them anymore. But that's originally where the name comes from. And it's cool. You can go to Hunters Point Park South and see these blooming in the spring, I believe, a little later.
More like in the summer.
Summer.
They're going to be full of a lot of blooms.
Yeah.
The entire length.
Yeah, and they're beautiful. And so you can see where the original marshmallow came from. And then you can also look for the graham cracker bushes off to the side. graham cracker bushes. And this is another beautiful summer flower. This blooms, I think, in like August and September, late summer, early fall. This is one of the many goldenrods, and this one's the most salt tolerant, and it's called, appropriately, seaside goldenrod. Now, this picture's from Long Island, somewhere in Long Island on the beach, but they grow, well, we're on Long Island technically, right? Queens is part of Long Island, and sure enough, they grow there as well. And this is a very hardy plant. You'll even see it in places that have been pretty modified, like bulldozed, even shorefront parking lots. If there's a crack in the concrete of the parking lot or the pavement, you'll see these sometimes popping up in the cracks. So they're very resilient and beautiful plant, and they have this yellow flower. A lot of times people in the summer or early fall will blame goldenrod for allergies. I think it's because there's other flowers that cause allergies that are blooming at that time, like ragweed, for example. Goldenrod's pollen is pretty big. You'll see bees going to it a lot. Usually only wind-blown pollen from plants that are wind-pollinated is fine enough to go up your nose and make you sneeze. This has a larger pollen that bees and other things pollinate, butterflies. So this is not actually the thing causing your allergies, but it's a beautiful plant. And if you look carefully at this photograph, you can see, well, I can see at least 3 or 4 monarch butterflies. Can you find them? 5? I see 5. See if you guys can find 5 monarch butterflies feeding on the nectar. The pollen, they don't feed on. It's just incidental. It sticks to them. But that's why the plant wants the butterflies and bees to come to their flower, because it pollinates them. But they provide nectar as a sweet treat to those butterflies. And for monarchs, they, of course, migrate all the way to Mexico. And so for them, it's really important to have these flowering plants where they can get enough nectar to fuel their journey. I think we actually have another plant, and then we have some more close-up butterfly pictures we'll get to. This is one that's called salt marsh elder or marine marsh elder. And just another native plant that's pretty common there, a little higher still. So you've got the Spartina alterniflora, Spartina patens, and then things like the marshmallow, the goldenrod, seaside goldenrod, and the marsh elder higher up. This has white flowers in clusters. And I don't know too much about this one, except that butterflies seem to like it, and it's grown abundantly there. Do you have any fun marsh elder facts, Mark? Not to put you on the spot. You just may know more than I.
So I just know that they're beautiful in the park, as you said, the white clusters. But yes, the swallowtails prefer those, and the monarchs like the goldenrods.
Get their favorite snack. There you go. Mark thought of everything. He gave both the butterflies, or two popular butterflies, their favorite plant. So here's the black swallowtail, one of the swallowtails that Mark mentioned. There's black and eastern tiger swallowtails there. It looks like this one's on some kind of thistle.
On thistle.
Yeah, but they also like the thistle, I think, is often considered something more of a weed because it's prickly, but there are many native thistles. Some gardeners consider these guys to be kind of a pest because their caterpillars like things in the carrot family. So if you're growing parsley or carrot or dill or fennel, the black swallowtail caterpillars will come and munch on them. But they're really cool looking caterpillars and they're beautiful butterflies. So I think they're worth losing a few carrot tops for.
That's right.
And then, of course, the really iconic butterfly in our region is the monarch. They have a number of generations over the course of the summer. And here's another one on goldenrod, seaside goldenrod again. And you can see some Spartina grass in the background. This was probably taken in the park, right?
Yes, this was taken in late September into October. We have the migration. It's as the temperature starts to drop. So we have an influx of monarchs in the park. And
yes,
on here on the goldenrod and on the asters, that they feed a lot, and it's something very beautiful to see.
It's very beautiful. Waterfront. And yeah, they have multiple generations over the course of the summer. So some of the ones returning, migrating north again, will be showing up maybe in late April, early May. The migratory populations are larger and thicker wing. They're actually stronger too for the rigors of migration. And then they'll have a couple of generations of young over the summer that'll turn into adults that are smaller and a little softer. And then their grandkids will be the ones that migrate south again. And those are the larger, usually deeper orange and stiffer winged adults that undertake that migration. And the ones that Mark mentioned that are feeding on these flowers in September would be the October. Those are the ones that are southbound. And they'll be quite late sometimes, like close to a frost. I've seen them in late October, even early November, and that's when the migration is really in full swing. I would say late October, it kind of peaks. And they follow the coastline. That's how they navigate. Sometimes you'll see them out over the open ocean even, coasting, soaring over the waves. And so sometimes when there's the right winds and the right temperature, you'll see hundreds or thousands of them feeding and clinging on these seaside plants along dunes and coastal areas. And so creating this type of habitat is really essential. If they don't have anywhere to feed, it's a lot harder for them to undertake that really ambitious long distance migration. So it's really important to have these native plants for them to get nectar from.
I get nervous late fall when I see the monarchs because of the fluctuating temperatures. It could dip.
Yes.
It could be warm. I think I'm wondering if they're a little confused at times because of the global warming effect.
Climate change.
Yes, climate change is.
Yes.
And so, I think that that might be a part of the reduction in the monarch population.
Yeah, they've really declined, although they've actually been on an upswing lately, which is great, and possibly attributable to people planting more milkweed, which is what they breed on. They'll go to lots of different flowers to feed on nectar, but the caterpillars only eat one kind of plant, well, a few different kinds of plants called milkweeds. And so the females always lay their eggs on milkweed, and the young only eat milkweed. The adults, however, are a bit more diverse in their taste, and they'll go to various flowers with nectar, including milkweed. But yeah, as Mark said, you know, sometimes they call, instead of global warming, people say global weirding, right? Because you're having a lot of just climactic shifts. It's not necessarily warmer. Sometimes you get more snow or colder cold or more rain or drier. You know, it depends on your region. So I just saw a study about spring weather just being generally more unpredictable, greater swings, greater fluctuations. So you could have a cold snap later than, whereas it's apparently, unfortunately, there aren't that many records, but they've done some things like studying ice cores and tree core samples, different things to see what temperatures were before they were keeping records. And it looks like they were just generally more stable. So the spring and fall were more predictable. And that's important if you're a migratory animal. If you're a monarch that's trying to get to Mexico and beat the first frost, which could kill you, or if you're a warbler who's flying north in the spring from South America and you want to time your arrival to when the leaves are just starting to leaf out and the first little tasty caterpillars are on those juicy, fresh leaves, well, you don't know. In South America, you don't have a, you know, those birds don't have a weather app. They don't know what the temperatures are like up here or what the leaves are like. So for them, that reliable, predictable quality is really important. And one thing we're seeing now with climate change is just things are just unpredictable and weird. And that's really difficult for wildlife because they need to plan their lives. And they've evolved to have their timing of migration, you know, to really be just, you know, just before the first frost or just when the leaves come out over thousands and millions of years. And suddenly things are changing very quickly. Yeah. But everything we can do helps. So creating habitat, creating food sources is important. So
these kinds of programs are also important because monarchs had declined very seriously. People noticed it. And then there was a huge initiative to start tracking them, to start various citizen scientist projects so that you could see how the migrations were going so people could figure out where a lot of the issues were, which has helped the populations bounce back a little bit after, you know, I think maybe 10 years ago when they were doing very poorly. Just the numbers in Mexico where they were wintering were just not good.
Yeah. So. Yeah, monarchs seem to be bouncing back.
Yeah.
It's complicated because there's a lot of factors too. It may have to do with certain pesticides that are being used, agricultural chemicals, with habitat loss, with climate change, probably all of them. And so sort of parsing out what the major threat is, how to address the different threats is challenging. That's true with a lot of animals and plants.
A very beautiful butterfly.
Yeah, I've always wanted to see them where they winter in the pine forests in Mexico, just by the hundreds of thousands all clustered together. Sometimes if you're lucky, last monarch thought, and then I'm going to move on to this poor bird who's waiting patiently here. If you're lucky along the coast in Long Island, I've not seen this along the East River, but maybe out in the Rockaways. I've seen it also in Cape May, New Jersey, and some other areas. Sometimes when there's a heavy migration with a cold front with the monarchs, it's almost like I've seen pictures of how they are in Mexico, where thousands of them are clustered together, particularly in coastal conifers. So if you find a stand of cedar trees, for example, along a dune, you can see thousands of monarchs all clinging together in those trees, turning those trees orange. So maybe you don't have to go all the way to Mexico to see something like that. You could try the Rockaways or Plum Beach in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. So this bird, speaking of creatures affected by climate change, this is a really iconic species that's tied exclusively to this habitat and the Spartina alterniflora we were talking about. This is the Spartina alterniflora grass here in close-up with the little seeds. And this is called a salt marsh sparrow. And it only lives in tidal salt marshes, or that's the only place it nests. And it primarily eats the seeds of the Spartina alterniflora in the summer and also catches little salt marsh grasshoppers. There's all these different little grasshoppers that in a big salt marsh, you can hear them in the summer trilling and making different noises. And that's what these little sparrows feed their babies. And they really only live in that habitat from southern Maine down to about North Carolina. So it's a very limited range. And the width of the range is the width of that salt marsh habitat, which you can see some beautiful, really extensive salt marshes. If you want to imagine what New York City may have been like at one time, you have to go to New Jersey, really. The biggest ones that I've seen are down between like Atlantic City and Cape May. There's incredible salt marshes. I mean, just acres and acres. But even the widest ones are maybe, 2 miles wide. So this bird's entire range is however many miles it is from southern Maine to North Carolina by 2 miles. So it's a really narrow strip of the coastline, and that's where it nests. And so scientists and birders are concerned that this might be one of the first birds driven to extinction by climate change in modern times because of sea level rise and storm surges. So again, they rely on a certain predictable range of tides and temperatures. And what we're seeing is much like temperatures are swinging around in unpredictable ways, the tides and storms are too. And of course, it's all connected, right? Warmer air holds more water that creates more rain and bigger storms, more wind, which creates bigger storm surges. And so they would nest in June and July, and their eggs aren't waterproof. If they get swamped by a wave, that then the eggs won't survive for long. And so if there's big storm surges, they can lose their nests. The adults are okay. They can fly to higher ground. However, they can't just move out of a marsh. They've evolved to live in a marsh and eat marsh grasshoppers and Spartina alterniflora seeds. And so they're sort of tied to that habitat. So hopefully we can create more of this habitat, because a lot of it's been lost, not before climate change or anthropogenic climate change, I should say. We were already filling marshes, as Jessica mentioned, and dredging them and stuff like that. So the sparrow was already having a tough time. And they're so cute. Look how cute. And sometimes in migration, they turn up in funny places. I've seen them in Bryant Park once or twice. But usually they stick to, that's in Manhattan. Usually they stick to salt marshes even during migration, even when they're not nesting. Full disclosure, I've never seen one in Hunters Point Park South or Gantry Plaza State Park. But I'm hoping now that that habitat's there that they might show up. So every time I go there to lead a bird walk, which we're going to talk more about in a little while, I keep an eye out and hope to find one of these guys, or maybe a flock. Maybe the leavens
are missing. I'll keep my eye open too for them.
Please do. Look for the orange face and the little blue-gray cheeks and kind of a long beak for, like, long thin beak for a sparrow. Mm-hmm. They're hard to see, though. They're like little mice scurrying around in the grass. They stay in that dense, low spartina right at the tide line, and they can be very difficult to see. They're good at hiding.
If you do get involved in birding, though, and you do happen to see one of them at the park, you can report bird sightings so that other birders who are interested can know that there might be one or two there, and they can go and look and start gathering that data. And Gabriel, I'm going to put the name of the site on you because I'm blanking on it, unfortunately.
Bird, ebird.org.
Yes.
It's E-B-I-R-D dot, I think it's .org or maybe .com. Just type ebird in a browser and you'll find it. You can create an account, and it's free, and it's a community science project, and the public can use it. And you can upload all your sightings. You can add photos. You can see what other people have been seeing. And there's different popular birding areas called hotspots. And Hunters Point Park South is a hotspot. Gantry Plaza State Park is its own hotspot. So you can look up under Explore. You can explore hotspots and look for Hunters Point Park South, for example, and see what other local bird watchers have seen. And it's pretty cool. And so if you see a salt marsh sparrow, you should definitely report it, but you should be pretty confident what you're seeing. You know, there's also house sparrows around. You want to make sure it's not a house sparrow, for example.
I have a feeling from the description you said that they scurry on the underbrush. I have a feeling I've seen something scurrying in the grasses.
I bet they're there. They haven't been there when I've been there, or I haven't, yes. They haven't come out. This is another really iconic salt marsh bird. That it's a bit more widely distributed than the salt marsh sparrow. This one lives from the Gulf of Maine all the way around the Gulf Coast to Mexico, and even down, I think, the coast of Mexico. Further south, it's found in mangroves, but up here, it's found in salt marshes. This is called a clapper rail, kind of an interesting looking bird. It's a bit like a big chicken with a long beak. Well, I guess actually a small chicken. Although it's not related, it's distantly related to cranes, believe it or not, rails. And they're very secretive birds too, very hard to see. weirdly enough, I've also seen one of these in Bryant Park in Midtown Manhattan, and yet not in the proper habitat at Hunters Point Park South yet, but I hope to. So that's part of the exciting thing of going birdwatching and going on bird walks. You never know what you're going to find. So they're called clapper rails because they're call. They have this sort of clapping, kind of a, it accelerates. Click, 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 click. They're quite abundant. If you go out to the Salt Marsh Nature Center, which is in Marine Park, Brooklyn, that's a great place to go. You can get there on a public bus, city bus, and it has a nice little visitor center and trails. And so you could visit there if you want. And also the salt marsh sparrow does breed there. So it's a larger marsh. So they might require a bit more extensive habitat than is available in Hunters Point Park South. But in migration, I imagine they might stop by. And they also are another bird that's potentially threatened by storm surges and sea level rise because if the marsh habitat gets swamped. But I don't think they breed quite as low in the marsh grasses as the salt marsh sparrow. So they should be a bit more resilient to storm surges. But a pretty cool bird. And here's one of those warblers I mentioned. I just happen to know I've seen this one several times in the park, and I think they breed in Hunters Point Park South and probably Gantry Plaza State Park as well. They often like coastal or waterside willows and marsh elders and other shrubbery, such as the one that's in here, close to water, including coastal areas. And again, yellow warbler. There's a lot of warblers that are yellow, but this one, that's its actual official name, yellow warbler. This is maybe the yellowest. It even has little yellow feet you might be able to see there on the stick that it's perched on. This is a male. He's singing. Their song is Sweet, 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 I'm So Sweet. Sounds like they're saying. So if you go to Hunters Point Park South and you listen, earlier there was a slide with an island. There's a nice man-made island tidally, I think the water surrounds it, and then sometimes it's more of a peninsula, and there's a little footpath out to it. And I know I've heard them and seen them out there. There's some nice shrubs and small trees on that island.
They're also by the red Adirondack chairs in Gantry Plaza on the willows.
Yes, I love willows. You see them. I think this one's in a willow in the photograph. Right, and there's those weeping willows over there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. Oh, this is another really iconic bird of the East River, really of coastal areas actually all around the U.S., including the East River. This is called a double-crested cormorant. Now, the crests are two little tufts of feathers on their head that aren't very visible. In the breeding season, which is right now, they sometimes have slightly more noticeable, they look like little horns. This one, I can't see any, but neat bird. Cormorant comes from the Latin corvus marinus, which means sea crow. Now, they're not actually related to crows. They're more related to pelicans. But they're all black, so they look somewhat crow or raven-like. And they also have these beautiful emerald green eyes. I don't know if you can make that out. And then this orange little sort of bare skin on their face and a hook on their beak. And they are champion divers. They dive underwater, not from the air, but they swim and then submerge themselves and swim underwater. They can stay underwater for about 2 minutes, hold their breath, and they chase fish. And that hook on their beak is for grabbing fish. And so they're just out there underwater in the East River swimming around. And to help them dive better, they actually have absorbent feathers. Most water birds have waterproof feathers. Their inner feathers, their down stays dry to keep them warm. But some of the outer feathers actually absorb water, and it makes them more dense, and they can dive better and go deeper. They can actually go about 70 feet deep, which is about how deep the East River is. So they might be down there right at the bottom of the East River chasing fish around. There's nowhere for those fish to hide. But then they're waterlogged and it's hard for them to fly. So you'll often see the cormorant standing like this sort of Dracula pose. And that's to dry their wing feathers so they can fly again. And they nest right across from Hunters Point Park South. This is a close-up of the island from, I think, the Manhattan side, possibly, or a little up. If you look in the distance, there's the Queensboro Bridge, the 59th Street Bridge on the left under the tree. Because this is probably from a boat close to the water. So this is Utant Island. You can see on the sign there. And Utant was the second Secretary General of the United Nations. And this is right in front of the UN Secretariat building there in Manhattan, in the East River. So adjacent to Hunters Point Park South. And that structure in the middle was a sculpture that has since collapsed. That arch is no longer there. This photo is from several years ago. And you can see the cormorants nesting in those trees. and also on the arch. They're not too picky. They'll nest on trees. They'll nest on metal structures. And those trees have also died because of all the cormorant guano, which is somewhat caustic, and it's killed the trees. So now you've got mostly dead trees, and they're nesting in dead trees now instead. And so it's pretty fun. You can stand in the park and look out in the East River and see them gathering sticks and feeding their young. And then you'll often see them right within the park on pilings looking for fish. So their whole life cycle is going on right there. If you look carefully, you can also see on the ground, there's some great black-backed gulls, which are a very large species of gull, the largest gull in the world. And they have these jet black backs that set them apart from other gulls, which generally have gray backs.
I just want to add that Utent Island is a man-made island, and it was used from the rocks that was excavated from the Steinway Tunnel, yes, which is the runs right under the East River, underneath Hunters Point South Park. So that's a man-made island that a lot of folks don't know. And at night, you can hear the cormorants. And on a quiet night, a still night, you could hear the cormorants in the distance from the queen side.
Oh, wow. They make pretty weird noises, kind of croaking sounds.
Yes.
Well, yeah, and Steinway, of course, of Steinway piano fame. There was a Steinway factory in Long Island City. And Mr. Steinway himself, I believe, was a bit of a visionary because he had this idea for a trolley tunnel. This was before subways existed. And he was like, what if a tunnel went under the river? Now, of course, we take that for granted, right? There's the Holland Tunnel, and you know, you can drive under the Hudson and the East River, the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel, excuse me, Hugh L. Carey Tunnel. There's lots of subway tunnels, but this didn't exist yet. So it was really quite visionary of him. I guess he, you know, made pianos and then got bored and had needed to do something with all that piano money. So he started building this trolley tunnel, and it was the first, I believe, under river tunnel in New York City. And it was never completed. And now I think it was finally finished and added, you know, not a while ago, it was added to the subway system. So that would probably be what the, does the 7 train go under the East River?
It's a 7, yes.
It's a 7 now.
The 7 tunnel train runs through the Steinway tunnel.
Right. So they it was not completed for trolleys, but then once the subways were, you know, in use, they said, oh, let's use this tunnel here. And yes, the rubble, as Mark said, from that process is what they used to make this island. I guess it was just probably somewhere to put the rubble. I don't know that the island ever had any other purpose. Now it's got a navigation tower on it with some lights and stuff for boats.
Yep.
And I do have to give a shout out here just to this amazing creature. Many of you probably know what this is. This is a horseshoe crab. Just an incredible, really iconic species, also of tidal regions. Salt marshes, bays, harbors, inlets, tidal straits, and estuaries. I just think they're amazing because they're so, so ancient. This is what's called a living fossil. There's really similar fossil horseshoe crabs that are 300 million, excuse me, years old, that predate dinosaurs. And there's relatives that look a little different going back, I think, about 400 million years. But there's virtually identical looking horseshoe crabs that are older than any dinosaur from fossils. And they have the same little compound eyes, which you can see there. They look a little scary, but they're harmless. They have that long tail spike, and they just use it to flip themselves over when a wave knocks them on their back. So you'll see a horseshoe crab with all that. It has all these different legs and these gills that are like pages in a book gills on their underparts, underside. And all these legs and little pinchers, and they look scary, but they're harmless. And if they get knocked over, they'll just use their tail and flip themselves right side up. And they come up on beaches around a full moon in late May or early June to lay their eggs and mate. And their eggs are a super important food source for migrating shorebirds, sandpipers, things like red knots, semi-palmated sandpiper, least sandpiper, which breed way up in the Arctic tundra and winter way down in South and Central America. The red knot has one of the longest migrations of any bird, and it times its migration to coincide with horseshoe crabs laying their eggs. And I believe further south, the horseshoe crabs lay their eggs earlier and around, when I say the full moon in late May or early June, that's New York. So the birds migrate along with the horseshoe crabs egg laying, and they get tasty, very nutrient-rich little horseshoe crab caviar snacks all the way up. But unfortunately, horseshoe crabs are also declining. They get caught and used a lot for bait and also for medical experiments.
They're so old that they're highly resistant to bacteria in a way that almost nothing is. So they're not killed for experiments always, but they're bled, which weakens them and hurts their ability to breed. But they were essential in even developing the COVID vaccines because of the process that can be used from their blood, which is bright blue, which is weird, in detecting contagions in vaccines and making sure they're actually safe. So.
Yep, our blood is iron-based, and that's why it looks red when it touches air, because it binds oxygen with iron, and their blood binds oxygen with copper, and it looks blue when it touches air. And yes, it coagulates very quickly around bacteria, more so than anything else, so it's a way to look for impurities in vaccines, as you said, Jessica. It's sort of very, seems like something out of a sci-fi novel or something alien. They look alien to begin with, but these scientists have them all in labs, all in rows with little tubes, and they're taking their blood and running it through machines and testing vaccines on them. And then they get their blood back and they get to get released again, but it does seem to weaken them and it may be, interfering with their ability to reproduce, which is unfortunate. So we need to help protect these horseshoe crabs. They're very special creatures. If you see one that's on the beach that's alive and maybe seems like it wants to be a little closer to the water, you could always move it back or just let it be and watch it do its thing. And sometimes, Mark, I believe you said we do see them in the park washed up, right?
By Gantry.
Yeah.
By Gantry, right by the library, actually.
So you can see them right near the library there. Really amazing creature and really important for the birds as well in the ecosystem. Just incredible that they've managed to hang on for so very long with so many changes. I mean, talk about climate change. Think about what the planet was like 300 million years ago. It was quite different than it is now. There was different levels of oxygen in the air and other gases and different temperatures. They lived through ice ages, and hopefully they can survive anthropogenic climate change. Pretty amazing creatures. Oh yes, look at that. It's almost time to wrap up. These are some of my favorite resources, some favorite books. Of course, this is we're talking to a library crowd, so I'm sure you all love books. So these are some favorite books about coastal ecology and specifically around New York City, wildlife and habitats. I'm sure you all probably, if anybody else has some favorites, maybe throw them in the chat. We can add, it doesn't just have to be a Q&A, it can be a book share too.
Certainly. And then we just sort of like to wrap up by inviting everyone to come if you'd like to see an in-person presentation of this. Gabriel will be doing 3 nature walks with us this spring, and then we'll be bringing him back in the fall to do some more Sunday morning on April 24th. And then on Sunday the 1st and on Friday, May 6th, I think I had those in the right order, at 5 p.m. If you want information on that or any of the other programs that we run, you can visit hunterspointparks.org. We also will be relaunching our volunteer program in the spring, starting on May 7th with I Love My Park Day in Gantry, which, as Mark mentioned earlier, is really essential to keeping these restored ecosystems functional, removing a lot of the invasives that can really be a detriment to the native grasses. And on April 9th, actually, the Newton Creek Alliance will be doing a volunteer project to help the median on 48th Avenue, which we and they planted together, which is a really fantastic pollinator garden. So you can go there, you can see a lot of the native butterflies and bees, really giving them a chance to have some place to stop in the middle of all of these very tall concrete areas in the city, to help really give them a little place to hang out, to enhance the number of plants available that are on the in addition to the parks, and to, bring them into the city as a whole. You can sign up with them or through our website to just really go out and, help keep the parks looking beautiful, help the various species that depend on these plants to really thrive. And thank you all so much for listening to coming to our presentation. I'm sure that Lynn will be joining us in a moment, and we can take any questions that you might have.
I just want to add that it's very important for us to have our volunteers coming out to help cleaning up and restoring the waterfront parks, but also the medians, the pollinators garden on 48th Avenue. That's like our, it welcomes a lot of butterflies, pollinators, bees, right on the waterfront. And I think it's very important to have people coming to help us and enjoy the waterfront. And thank you very much for listening.
Thank you all, Mark, Jessica, and Gabriel. This has been fabulous. I learned so many interesting little history and natural history tidbits there. And I can hardly wait to get back out to Hunters Point sometime soon. And we have a lot of cheers and exclamations from our audience. Let's see. Valerie says, I love yellow. I'm sure that's for the that adorable little warbler. And Renee said, I've seen them in Central Park. And also Renee's concerned about horseshoe crabs and hope they survive the challenges they're facing. And thank yous and cheers all around for our presenters today. And I want to remind our viewers, again, if you have any questions or more comments, we have another few minutes for those. And one of the things I wanted to ask you, I know you mentioned citizen science or community science a time or two, and April's coming up, and April is Community or Citizen Science Month. And I wondered, are you aware of any projects going on specifically in the park, or things that people can contribute their observations to science that they could do in the park or elsewhere in natural areas around the city? I'm putting you on the spot. Sorry about that.
Well, there's several. The nice thing is most of them are broad enough that you could do them wherever you are. So like eBird, I mentioned, you can do that anywhere in the world. And there is also a community science project that I'm Googling right now on my phone, the exact name, but for monarch butterflies.
Journey North does it.
What's that?
Journey North is one of the, that's the one that's just observational rather than tagging. But there's also a monarch tagging one.
Journey North, there you go.
JourneyNorth.org, yeah.
So if you see monarchs in your garden or at this park, you can, you could report that as well. I just Googled Monarch Community Science Project. There's a bunch. There's also, there's some wonderful apps, which the cool thing about them is they mostly just function as an app that can help you identify like a wildflower or a snail or a bird or whatever. But they also are creating databases of where things are. Now, of course, that's just the first step, right? Knowing where something is and at what time of year, and then you can get more in depth and try to figure out more about it. But you need to know that it's there in the first place. So one that I use a lot is called iNaturalist. The letter I and then Naturalist. It has a smartphone app. And what's really cool is I tend to use eBird for birds, but iNaturalist I'll use for everything else. Wildflowers, insects, fungi, you name it. You can really put anything in there, but birds too. And it's got really smart facial recognition algorithms these days, and they're getting better and better. So it can really identify almost any plant. I'm traveling right now. I'm not in New York at the moment, but I was just down at low tide, found a really cool worm that I'd never seen before under a rock, because that's what I do. and sure enough, iNaturalist said it was the 15-scaled worm, and I'd never even heard of it, but iNaturalist knew. There it is. So that's really useful. And then all the data that you input there, scientists could use in ways we haven't even thought of yet. It's a public database. So later, you know, in years even, they might be like, huh, what date was this wildflower emerging in the spring? And how's that related to climate change, for example? And they could just look for all the records of that flower. So that's the cool thing about community science. It creates this big data, right? And then people can use it in all sorts of ways that we may not even anticipate. So those are my favorites, eBird, iNaturalist, and there's more specific ones where like classrooms can get involved with the monarchs and things like that.
Well, we have a couple of great questions related to volunteering. Thank you so much for that. Let's see, Renee asked, how do people volunteer? And then related, Valerie wanted to know, can children volunteer, or how do you, old do you have to be a volunteer?
Sure. So the easiest way to volunteer, because we haven't announced all of the dates yet, we're waiting to get some of the links for the signups. If you go to our website, which is hunterspointparks.org, you will see a little pop-up asking you to join our mailing list. And that's where we announce all of our activities, all of the volunteering we can do. You can also send us an email through the website or at info@hunterspointparks.org, and then we can add you to the list to be to let you know. We will be starting our volunteering in early May. We do Thursday mornings at 10 a.m. in Hunters Point South Park and Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. in Gantry Plaza State Park. And then on May 7th, we're going to be doing that big kickoff event in Gantry Plaza as part of a statewide volunteering day in the parks. Children are welcome to volunteer. We actually, at our biggest planting event in the fall, Bulb Fest, where we planted almost 16,000 bulbs last year. We had kids of all ages coming out. They are required to be accompanied by an adult, but we always have volunteers. I know Mark is out gardening all the time. So we have both our team out there and then gardeners from the city and the state parks out there to sort of help guide what you can do. And kids can help with pulling out weeds. One of the nice things about the grasses in the park is that they're very forgiving of gardening because they have, unlike sort of the grass in your yard, which doesn't grow very deep because it has very limited roots because we cut it all the time, grass that's been out there for a long time has this incredibly rich root system, which is both great for erosion and great as a carbon sink, but also means that it's really hard to accidentally yank it up when you're trying to pull out weeds, which can be forgiving if you have, you know, little kids out gardening with you. So,
and remember on April 9th, I believe, on the medians with the Newtown Creek Alliance. It's a major cleanup and cutback and on some weeding because some of the weeds are starting to sprout already.
Yes. So
we look forward to having volunteers. All ages welcome. And please wear hard closed-toe shoes.
Yes.
And we provide gloves and other equipment.
Yeah. So. Gloves and gardening tools and everything you need.
Yes.
Well, I wanted to note about iNaturalist on April 23rd, which would be 4 weeks from today. We have a program with Lisa Bloodgood, who's been a good friend to our Hunters Point programming, no longer with Newtown Creek, but very involved in planting that median. Yes. We're so happy to be welcoming her back. We are going to do a program about iNaturalist. And for those of you that want to take part and you're not familiar with iNaturalist, you can download the free app for your phone on either Apple or for Android phones. And Lisa's going to be instructing us, and that includes me because I have not used it much, on iNaturalist and encouraging people to take part in the City Nature Challenge, which is the following week. Starting the following week. And so you can hear more about that here on YouTube Live. And see if we have any other questions. One more about volunteering days of the week. And you may have covered that.
Sure. It's so in Hunters Point South Park, it's every Thursday at 10 a.m. And then in Gantry Plaza, it's every Saturday at 10 a.m. And then occasionally, if there's like a big project that needs work, like the medians or anything else, we'll announce additional volunteer days through our newsletter.
And if you have a group of co-workers, we have corporate days that we welcome volunteers up to 30, 40, 50 volunteers to do a major cleanup or gardening event.
It's a much
and I just want to add to that our parks are the world's largest classrooms. I call them. There's so much to learn from our parks, so please come and enjoy all of it. Thank you.
I love that idea of the park as a classroom, and you know, our city's a classroom, our world is a classroom. Yeah. Well, I want to thank you again for such a fabulous presentation. Thank you so much to our viewers out there. And remind you once again, next week, 2 o'clock here on YouTube Live. Be sure to join us for When You Flush, What Happens When You Send Things Down the Drain. And please like and share this video. They are available archived on the Queen's Library YouTube channel to view later on. And let's see, there you also can find links to programs and resources for the library, events, etc., on our website, queenslibrary.org. And I once again want to thank our funders for Hunters Point Environmental Education Center, the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by the City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And thank you so much, everybody. Have a wonderful weekend, and I hope to see you back next week. And thanks again to our presenters. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye.